The next item on the order paper is a motion on Health and Wellbeing 2026, Delivering Together and Systems, Not Structures, Changing Health and Social Care. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 2 hours for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the Marshall list. The proposer of the amendment will have 10 minutes to propose and the amendment and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I'll ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly notes the publication of Health and Wellbeing 2026, Delivering Together, and Systems, Not Structures, Changing Health and Social Care.
I call Ms. Joanne Dobson to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to move this motion in the House today. The first opportunity that members have to make substantive comments on the issue. And I welcome, as I and my colleagues did on the 25th of last month, the publication of the findings of Professor Rafael Bengoa and his panel. Indeed, we had the opportunity to meet with the panel at the Health Summit in the Stormont Hotel in February, and again for 45 minutes at the beginning of June. The commitment of the expert-led panel was resolute, and I'm sure we can all thank them for their many months of work. We therefore welcome their conclusions, which it has to be widely noted, are similar in the findings of the three previous major health reviews, advocating, as it does, a shift from acute to community care. Mr. Speaker, the one thing that we can, with certainty, learn from history is that we never learn from history. I remember at the summit putting it to Professor Bengoa that reforming the health service is a little like repairing an airplane in flight. He and his panel have provided the executive with the direction of travel. The job of carrying out that reform, therefore, lies with them. The publication of Health and Wellbeing 2026, Delivering Together, and Systems Not Structures, Changing Health and Social Care, marks just that, the publication of two documents. Mr. Speaker, that is why the devil is in the detail, and as yet we have not been provided with that detail. It was with some surprise just how high level the Minister's response was. She had the Bengoa findings for 10 weeks, yet even some of her more detailed actions still only referred to further exploration and consultation. For instance, Action Point 12 announced the establishment of a transformation oversight structure by November. However, the Minister really should have been in a position to tell us when launching the action plan, who was going to sit on the panel, how they would be selected, and what their terms of reference were going to be. An example of uncertainty and delay that could have so easily been avoided. I still believe, however, and has been a point I've heard made several times since the publication of the documents 3 weeks ago, it was galling that the very first action was by January next year to develop a comprehensive approach to addressing waiting times. And I know that many were generally surprised at that. No one disagrees with the fact that there's a problem, but most will be shocked to learn that the executive hadn't a plan in place already to deal with it. Throwing money at it in year, as happened over recent years, hasn't worked. Remember, £18.5 million of the £40 million last year wasn't spent on tackling waiting lists because health trusts weren't given enough time to spend it. So following the publication of the two documents last month, there has been some focus on the centralisation of services. So let me make the Ulster Unionist Party position crystal clear. We agree with localising where possible and centralising where medically necessary. So what does that look like in reality? It means we support some services which are being delivered in an unsustainable and unsafe manner, coming together when there's a clear and compelling medical case to do so. But what we won't support is the word unsustainable being manipulated to suit the department's agenda, as clearly happened with paediatric congenital heart services in Belfast. One example of a service which you want to see kept as they are is the current provision of emergency departments. There are 9 Type 1 sites in total, including the units at the Royal Victoria, and they're all under immense strain as it is. We don't need to think back too long to remember what happened at the Belfast City Hospital. In the year before its closure was announced, the hospital had 45,000 attendances, and yet, after it was shut, there was only minimal increase in capacity at the Royal and the Ulster. No wonder the 4-hour NE performance in the Royal was only 69%, yet in the July before the city's closure, it was 78%. I would like Mr Speaker to give an example where the present decentralised service relieves pressure on the main specialised unit, and that is nephrology. From our own personal experience, my son was treated in the Belfast Hospital for Sick Children and then latterly in the nephrology unit at the City Hospital. A successful unit, indeed last year equaling the UK record of transplants performed in a single unit in a single day. Once successfully post-surgery and into a management regime of drugs, Mark was repatriated to the care of the Southern Trust at the nephrology unit at the Daisy Hill Hospital, Newry, under the expert care of consultant nephrologists Dr John Hardy and Dr Neil Morgan and their team. As a family and from our experience, this was an excellent positive change for Mark, and it also takes pressure off the consultants and their team at the City Hospital. Because when we were attending the clinics in Belfast, immunosuppressant patients were effectively lining the walls, waiting on their appointments. Not a safe environment for patients susceptible to infection. So if the Minister is going to come forward with the business case, the funding and a plan to establish a centralised, and I give this as one example, nephrology service, then those plans will need to be funded, carefully planned, and the impact on patients both short-term and long-term taken into consideration. Mr Speaker, I give this just as an example of precisely the level of detail which was missing from the Bengoa report and the executive's responses. The principles are well established and indeed widely supported, but the how, the when and the where has not been brought forward. To give a further example, when lobbying on behalf of a constituent earlier this year who needed an appointment at the Regional Immunology Service, the Belfast Trust confirmed to me, and I quote, "With demand outweighing capacity, the current waiting time for an adult allergy appointment is up to 22 months. 22 months during which patients risk coming to harm. Indeed, the latest information we have from July shows 1,094 patients were waiting longer than 52 weeks for an allergy appointment. And this is already a centralised service. So, Mr Speaker, workforce planning, long-term budgeting and actions are required to fix a broken service. So far, Mr Speaker, we have a 12-month timeline for a 10-year plan with budgets at worst for 1 year and at best for 3 to 4. Mr Speaker, if I could make one plea to the Executive today, it would be this. Bring forward the detailed and costed plans for reform. Back them up with long-term budget, as has happened in other regions. There was initial disappointment that the announcement of the Executive's plan was not met on the same day by an injection of funding through October monitoring round. Officials have since confirmed that the 18 actions are being managed within existing resources. I would, however, be grateful for clarity from the Minister on the comments of her officials at Health Committee last week. They indicated to me that no monitoring round had been commissioned for January, and given the overcommitment of the Executive, they were not envisaging getting any additional allocations in January. Minister, stable budgets are one thing, but having the departmental culture that embraces change and nurtures rather than suppresses the talents of those healthcare professionals will achieve the best outcomes. and as I put to Dr McBride at committee back in June, the department must loosen its iron grip. Accountability certainly, but a stranglehold which stifles individual thinking will ensure that real and meaningful change simply drips down slowly, far too slowly. The Minister last week stated that it will take strong leaders to take forward transformation, and I agree. And Minister, I do not envy for 1 minute the task of repairing that aeroplane in flight. In conclusion, Mr Speaker, the future holds many challenges for our people, not least type 2 diabetes, liver cirrhosis, lung and heart disease and, of course, cancer. But the past shows a litany of failed opportunities to support and strengthen our health service. We welcome and will be supporting the amendment
to conclude her remarks.
I therefore urge the Minister to tell us the how, the when and the where to lift that curtain, the certain uncertainty, and begin to tackle this issue.
Call Ms Paula Bradshaw to move the amendment.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. I rise to propose the amendment and, of course, to support the motion, but also welcome the Health Minister being present this afternoon in the Chamber to hear this debate. It is important to put on record that this Assembly needs to get behind the principles behind this transformation process. To make an obvious but important point, reform is a complex matter. It will be natural for people to oppose aspects of it, but change is always uncomfortable. It will not be enough merely to repeat why change is necessary, but that bears repeating. Firstly, there is the financial issue, which is often referred to. That if we do not reform, we simply will not be able to afford the health service, which is free at the point of access at present, in 10 or 15 years' time. Secondly, and more importantly, the fact is the system is in some ways broken, so it does need to be mended. We do need to centralise specialised services, as my colleague Ms Dobson referred to there, to maximise available expertise. We do need to ensure more is done at the point of entry to the system, notably within primary care, to direct people to the appropriate places. We do need to invest more in health and wellbeing, preventative work, not least in mental health, to support people to manage their own health and those for those people that they're caring for. So our amendment calls on this Assembly to recognise the value of reform, the need to support it in principle and without reservation. Otherwise, the health service simply will not be viable, and the brilliant and very committed people working within it will not be able to deliver the results they want to deliver. I have said before, and I will say again this afternoon, that if the Minister proceeds with the transformation, she will have my party's support, even where measures are challenging. This does not mean that we will commit to support the Minister in everything she does, because we have not had a chance to see what exactly it is she proposes to do. Her announcements so far have lacked full detail, but this is not unreasonable at this stage, but we do want to see more meat on the bones in the very near future. It has been said that the transformation process will take 2 Assembly terms. Again, very reasonable. However, it cannot be an excuse for not making considerable progress within this current Assembly term. So we need clarity. What we need is a full action plan. Where are the resources for it? And who is going to be responsible for different aspects of delivering on that reform? Not everything will run perfectly, but we do need an action plan that we can assess as members of this Assembly, so that we can make sure that the reform process is taking place. But we also need to remember that this is not just about MLAs in this chamber. This is about the general public and the people who use our health service. The general public are the most important aspect of this. So what should be in the action plan? Firstly, we must need absolute clarity, which, to be fair, the Minister has already indicated she is prepared to give, as to where the differences are between her own roadmap and the report of the expert panel as chaired by Professor Bengoa. And I would echo the comments of Ms Dobson again. You know, it was a truly an expert report, and I think that we would be foolish not to follow it. And certainly would put on record my thanks to Professor Bengoa and his panel for the work on it. So the Minister has said that hers is the only roadmap in town, and that may be wise, but we do need to be clear what that relates to in terms of the expert panel's report. Secondly, we need a clear indication as to the resource requirements for the transformation. And this isn't just about financial, but this is all about personnel and the use of facilities. We need clarity too as to the resource requirement that will be required throughout the Assembly term and beyond it. We need to recognise that it is necessary to know where it is coming from, but also that it has been guaranteed. Thirdly, we need a series of actions and a commitment to clarity as to how and indeed if they will be delivered. Not everything will run smoothly, as I said. However, the implementation of the Transforming Your Care strategy was set back by uncertainty as to what had been implemented, because we know that things were implemented, but it wasn't just recorded very well. And what will not be, and as I say, there was never any doubt that implementation was needed, but as I say, people within the service weren't sure what was happening a lot of the time. Finally, we need clarity as to who will be responsible for the management of the transformation. Who will head up this board, this transformation board, providing oversight, and what level of expertise will be on that, beyond the board? This issue of assigning responsibility goes further. We also need a recognition in the plan, in line with the report of the expert panel and indeed the programme for government framework, that this will not be solely a matter for the Department of Health. Children's health, the role of welfare and housing and health, wellbeing in the workplace and so on fall to other departments. And of course, many aspects of health, and particularly health promotion, fall outside the government altogether. I think this transformation is possible. However, it will take commitment, it will take courage, and it will take clarity. Where those exist, my party will support the process every step of the way. Where it does not, my party will provide constructive challenge. I commend both the motion and the amendment to the House.
Call Ms. Paula Bradley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and can I thank both the proposer of the motion and also the proposer of the amendment, especially the proposer of the amendment, on her very positive contribution. It's good to see that. I always think that I am the only optimist in the room, but it's good to see that there's more than one of me here. And I also thank her for the amendment as well, because it puts a little bit more meat onto the motion, so we will be supporting that also. Also, can I also welcome the commitment by the executive also in their unanimous support on the implementation of the minister's plan for the future of health and social care. Mr. Speaker, as chair of the health committee and also as member of a health committee in recent months, I, along with others, have had the great pleasure of meeting many groups, whether that be the BMA, the RCN, all the various AHPs, and also social work as well, along with other people who work within health and social care. And during that journey over the past few months, I have seen a real difference and a real optimism also within all of those disciplines within health and social care. I attended an event here on Friday afternoon for the Royal College of Occupational Therapists, and they were launching a report to do with reducing the pressures on hospital admissions, which is something which we very much want to look at within the future of health and social care. And it just showed us again the innovative work that is happening day and daily amongst our allied health professionals here in Northern Ireland. So to say, at times we often look at our health and social care and say that we haven't done anything or it's been in a stalemate, I think very differently from someone who came from that background and who hasn't worked in that background for over 5 years, that I see so much innovative work taking place every day across our primary and secondary care. I also, a couple of weeks ago, again, had the pleasure of hosting a physiotherapy event where we heard from service users, which is probably the most important people to hear from in all of this, and especially to do with the self-referral in the South Eastern Trust, where we now have, and I think I said it in here before, over 7,000 people have used that initiative of self-referral. So that's something I'd like maybe the Minister to comment on in her travel with rolling that out further, because we know we've heard also in committee about the pressures facing our GP services and all of our primary care services, and how this vision for the future can make a real difference in that. I just wanted to just pick up on a few points. I was glad that Ms. Bradshaw had said that change is often uncomfortable, and I think that's one of the major dilemmas we are going to have here as an Assembly as we go forward in this mandate and future mandates ahead of us when it comes to health and social care. Mrs. Dobson had said earlier about the closures
of any our ED departments, and that she didn't wish that to happen. I know it's very comfortable for me, as a Belfast MLA, to often look at everything else around the rest of our province and think, oh, I think we could do that better. I think if we closed that and we moved that there and we made that a special hub for this, or we did that, I can say that with great comfort, because I know on my doorstep I have everything. I have absolutely everything here in Belfast, and I'm so glad to have that. And I know, though, from my DUP colleagues on these benches, we will face problems, and I think the Minister will also face problems from her own benches and her own colleagues, because we do have tough decisions to make. Really tough decisions are ahead of us. I think, though, there is the momentum. I think there is the will. I've heard it from everybody in this chamber that they all want to see change and they want to effect change. As I said before, I'm glad that Ms. Bradshaw had brought her amendment forward, because I do think there needs to be an implementation plan. I think that uncertainty out there will start to see some people become cynical. And that's not just members within this chamber becoming cynical, but that's service users and also those that work within that service. So I think that we do need to see that progress. We need to have something more stable in place, and that goes for the budget as well. I know we had a witness session last week within Health Committee to do with the budget, and quite frankly, it wasn't good enough for us. We do need to see more. We need to have more ideas written down. As I'd said earlier, meeting all of these people over the past, what, 5-6 months now, that work within social care, and also those many, many service users, there's an appetite for change. There's a hunger for change. There's an appetite and a hunger within this chamber for change. I want to add my support to what the Minister and her long journey ahead.
Ask the member to conclude her remarks.
And support of both the motion as amended. Thank you.
I call Ms. Catherine Seeley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank my colleagues in the UUP for bringing forward this motion. I did think it signified a mature enough approach from them, a party who have over the last number of weeks failed to embrace the report and indeed the Minister's vision, despite the fact that it has been welcomed and embraced right across the sector, as well as in the media, and most importantly by patients, carers and staff. This is the mother of all opportunities. But opening comments from the UUP suggest the same old negativity and, of course, a lack of any viable alternatives. This same old glass-half-empty approach will get us nowhere. We are extremely appreciative of the efforts, commitment and dedication of Professor Bengoa, as well as his expert panel. And whilst our amendment reflecting this was not accepted, the Alliance amendment does in some way attempt to acknowledge the expert analysis. Bengoa's report issued us with a harsh dose of reality. In his report, he describes the health service as being on a burning platform. He warns that change is inevitable. We have no choice but to implement change, but we do have a choice as to the circumstances in which it is implemented. Now, at a time we can manage change whilst double running our health and social care service, or later, following a system collapse, when we will be managing change in crisis. The amendment states that reforms must be implemented in a holistic manner without delays, and calls on the Minister to provide a detailed action plan for the implementation of the proposed reforms over the current Assembly term. The Minister has acted without delay. She has outlined a plan for the next 12 months, will build on that plan again in January, and has committed to reporting to this House every 6 months. It makes you wonder if the parties sitting outside of the executive have been listening. That said, given that the Minister is already doing what the amendment calls for, we have no issue in supporting today's amendment as well as today's motion. Our demographics have changed so drastically in the last 20 years, yet our health and social care service has remained static. People are living longer, but with much more complex need. It is therefore vital that our health and social care service responds to that. The vision the Minister has outlined aims to tackle waiting lists, improve access to GP services, achieve parity of esteem for mental health, raise the attainment of looked-after children, reform adult social care and support, develop a workforce strategy, fully realise the potential of community pharmacists, as well as a feel of the many and invaluable community services and good practices already out there. Her plans are ambitious, but then they need to be. Bengoa, in comments to the committee, suggested that the implementation of the Minister's vision had the potential to result in the delivery of a world-class health and social care system. He said that the minister had gone further than any other equivalent European minister he had ever worked with. These words should inspire confidence right across the political divide. There have, of course, been opportunities for change in the past, but change is a brave choice. It can be slow, frustrating, and it is certainly not populist. That is why it is vitally important that we do not play politics with this. Countless members will speak today. Each of them will note the pending crisis in our health service. But a minister alone cannot deliver the change that is needed, so we must all put our shoulder to the wheel. As politicians, we must lead this change. We must engage our communities early, most of whom are already ahead of us. I would urge members to consider what is more important, populism or patient wellbeing, convenience or quality, cheap headlines or action. If we are serious about improving patient outcome, if we are serious about tackling health inequalities, then we need to get behind this vision. And in the short term, we must allow the Minister the space to meaningfully engage with health and social care staff and patients so that in partnership her vision can be built on and advanced, it can grow and develop to ensure that the end result is a world-class health and social care system that will be the envy of the world.
Call Mr. Colin McGrath.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to be able to discuss this important motion today, and welcome the fact that my Ulster Unionist colleagues and Alliance colleagues have brought it here today. And I suppose that's the first thing maybe to note, that in the interest of openness and transparency, something that this executive isn't particularly good at, it has taken an opposition party to bring the substantive discussions here today. But, Mr. Speaker, any effort to improve the health of people is essential and it is required. But I worry about reports that are published that then become bookends or dust gatherers. I mean, we have had delivering better services, we've had transforming your care, we've had the Donaldson report, and now we have the latest, the Bangor report. These series of reports are only useful if they provide a concrete blueprint of what must be done for the future of our health services and then are actioned. It has been said that this report is more of a direction of travel rather than a report of defined proposals. And I hope that that won't be interpreted as a report of wishy-washy aspirations and instead is something that will deliver. Quickly.
We've had all of those reports, and that's right, but none of them were under this minister. I think that the member will agree with that.
I thank the member for her contribution. We're discussing the report, not the minister, so I think we'll stick to the topic. I welcome many elements of the report, but again, I find it would be difficult to argue with any elements in the report. We want a healthy population, of course. We want people to live longer, of course. We want people to access proper, decent, expert health care when they need it, of course. We want people to avail of services at home where possible and not in hospital, of course. We want to challenge the root cause of many of the presenting illnesses to our health service by challenging poverty, dealing with obesity, and improving a healthy and fit lifestyle, of course. Who wouldn't? I'm just a little concerned that this report tells us much of what we already know, and not very much of what we haven't yet got. And what is it that we need? Well, I think that we need to see ambulance response times improved in rural areas. They get you to the hospital. We need emergency departments that can cope and don't have long queues. Maybe you could reopen the Down accident emergency and that would help. We need to stop seeing trolleys on the corridor as acceptable health care. We need more consultants who can screen and direct patients to the care that they need. We need beds available for patients that need them. We need elective surgery waiting time slashed. We need outpatient appointments in a reasonable time. We need proper community care for people at home, not a 10-minute dash and run service, leaving our elderly bewildered rather than cared for. And we need to treat staff with dignity and the decency and pay them a fair wage and reimburse them for the costs of their work. It's not fair that some in our health service are out of pocket when they go to work. I could go on and on, Mr. Speaker, on and on. And I read the report and worry that Bangoa has said much, but I wonder, has he really said anything at all? Where are the concrete outcomes? Where are the timescales? Where are the measurables? Are they financed? Are they ready to go? I don't envy your work, Minister. I think you have a mammoth task ahead. But help was sought. Help has produced this report. and I wonder, is it really the help that we actually have needed? I hope that we're not going to just be kicking problems down the line. I hope that we have the plans to deal with them. I also know that it has taken years to build up, but saying that it will take 10 years to sort out this problem is a bit long. I think that it's a disservice to our people and their healthcare workers to say that it's going to take that long. I think we need to see something quicker and in the short term. The lack of clarity around the financial element of the report is also of concern. We are completely lacking in costs associated to the process and or an indication of where the money will come from. With no money requested from the Department for Health in the October monitoring round to deal with the urgent waiting list crisis we are facing, the lack of detail around costs of delivering the much-needed action plan promised in this report is a bit worrying. I will conclude, Mr. Speaker, by echoing the sentiments of my colleague, Mr. Durkin, on the launch of the report and by reaffirming the SDLP's commendation and support of our healthcare staff on their vigorous work in providing healthcare across the North. The work and effort of our healthcare workers is second to none, and it cannot be put on them that their efforts do not translate to a first-class health service. We remain optimistic that this process will begin to resolve problems faced in the health and social care, and we look forward to seeing an action plan and detailed costs going forward. We do, of course, pledge to work constructively with the Minister.
I call Mr. Gary Middleton.
Mr. Speaker, and can I welcome the opportunity to speak today and of course welcome the publication of both of the reports, one from the expert panel and the other from the Minister. And I would like to thank the expert panel for the work that they've carried out as well, and of course the Department for setting a pathway as to how we're going to go about implementing this change. In the expert panel's report, they've put a clear statement. The choice is not whether to keep services as they are or to change to a new model, but put bluntly, there is no meaningful choice to make. The alternatives are either plan change or change prompted by crisis. And the Chair touched on the fact that as Health Committee members, we meet with various groups weekly, and last week we had a stakeholder event with a wide representation of various groups who made it very clear to us that they recognise the change that has to happen. And I think it's very disappointing that so far from the opposition parties, and I don't obviously include the Alliance Party in this, but from opposition parties the tone has been very negative. I don't think they've given the report a chance. It's only been out a matter of days. And I think they need to reflect on that and get behind the public opinion and the professional opinion as well. I will.
Forgive way. I'm somewhat surprised when the member refers to the tone. We are welcoming the findings of the Bengo report, but we're asking for detail for a costed, funded plan. Surely you would agree with that. That's essential on putting patients first.
Member has an extra minute.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Speaker. It wasn't the point that I was making. It was referring to the tone and the negative tone. And it is unfortunate that there has been a knee-jerk reaction to these publications. We've seen that in the media. And unfortunately for some members, they should reflect on those media positions and get real with the facts and wait for a sort of a response from the Minister. In terms of the expert panel, I'm going to just try and make some progress. In terms of the expert panel's report, it makes it very clear as to the challenges. It makes it clear that we need to draw on the experience of those who already deliver care and taking on that expertise, building on the existing foundations that are already there, continuing the positive work, because we have to remember there's much positive work already happening in the health service. We shouldn't be running our health service down. We're here to make sure that that work is continued, but reforming it and making it better as well. Of course, we need to communicate the plans, and I think the Minister so far has done that in outlining the 12-month vision and what needs to happen over the next 12 months, the need for additional transitional funding as well, and of course the Transformation Board, which will see all of this through. Innovation was touched on by my colleague, the Chair of the Health Committee, and I think it's no longer acceptable that we keep doing things as was just for the sake of it or for the fact that we've been doing it for 20 years. I think we need to be looking at innovative ways of doing things, and we know that there's much innovation within our health service at this minute in time. The need for addressing elective care performance, and we know that there is going to be a strategy released in January as to how we address that. Of course, the difficulty will be trying to manage the addressing the waiting times and ensuring that we push forward with the transformation. But that's where we need clear leadership not only professional or clinical, we need political leadership. And I think the executive has given a clear commitment to showing that leadership, and I think we need to see that from others outside of the executive as well. In terms of keeping staff on board, I think it's vital that the Minister keeps ensuring that there's conversations happening within the staff, ensuring that they feel valued and ensuring that they're kept up to speed with the changes that are required. With all of the recommendations in the report, the clear outcome of that is that there is a willingness within the staff to make the change that's required. The Health and Wellbeing 2026 vision outlines the pathway on how we're going to make these changes. Recognising the challenges of the change in population and the health inequalities which exist within our communities, it's no longer acceptable that you live in a certain community that your access to services is going to be different or you're going to be disadvantaged. You know, in some communities, of course, we know that you're twice as likely to die from smoking or you're three times as likely to die from suicide. These health inequalities are no longer acceptable. And I think these reforms will see that our communities get the health service that they deserve. And we have to recognise, of course, finance alone will not solve this. We need to fully implement what the report says, and we look forward to working with the Minister to ensure that that happens. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Ian Mill.
Kim Collier. I thank you for this opportunity to speak in regarding the motion currently before us and in support of the amendment tabled also. Again, I take an opportunity to commend Minister Michelle O'Neill on having launched Health and Wellbeing 2026, Delivering Together, a 10-year vision to transform the North's health and social care system. As we know, this is an opportunity for a fresh start, supported by the executive, not just the will of one minister or one department. Minister O'Neill's vision was compiled after considering the report Systems, Not Structures, Challenging Health and Social Care, by a panel of experts led by the highly esteemed Professor Rafael Bengoa. A report which has received considerable support for the need for change from vast numbers of people working in our health and social care sectors, including the BMA and AHPS, who signalled general approval. As our Health Minister has stated on previous occasions, the system itself is now at breaking point and facing a number of challenges, not least the demographic changes and considerable health inequalities which continue to persist. It is well past the time to organise services in a way which does not constrain transformation on our ability to provide a higher quality service. There can be no doubt that we need to support people to keep well in the first place, and when we need care and support, services should be safe and of the highest quality. I agree with the Minister that our focus must move from one which is based on action-based targets to one based on patient outcomes and co-production of services. Health care professionals and staff across the relevant sectors are working harder than ever to deliver high-quality care and support to patients and carers, but they are having to work in a health and social care system designed to meet the 20th century needs that does not work in the 21st century world. Changing the health system is the right thing to do. It's the right time to do it, and is much needed by service users. Change must be planned, managed, and incremental. It will not happen overnight. This will take time and resources and the support of staff as well as everyone who use the health and social care services. We must avoid playing political politics with health. We all need to support evidence-based decisions when presented. Gurumil Mugat.
Well, Mr. Roy Beggs.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I too rise to support the motion in the name of my colleague Joanne Dobson and others, and indeed the amendment proposed by the Alliance Party. Health is not just about statistics, it's about real people's lives and how we must act to improve the quality of their life. There are a number of recommendations contained within this Health and Wellbeing Report 2016. They're aimed at helping to stabilise, reconfigure and improve the health service and transform it. But what we need is much more details, much more detailed action plans about how it's going to be delivered, how it's going to be improved, not just this high-level strategy. Until that is seen, there will not be a clear picture that the public can have confidence that will be followed. The very first recommendation is to develop a comprehensive approach to addressing waiting lists. Why has our executive allowed our waiting list to deteriorate to such an extent at present? Totally unacceptably long waiting lists, which is causing stress, anxiety to constituents. Undue delays in patient treatment can sometimes mean a greater likelihood of the individual coming to harm, with many facing short-term adverse impact on the quality of their lives, and they may even have longer impact because of the delays in treatment. There's additional visits to A&E at present and costly unplanned admissions to hospital. I can think in particular of one constituent who recently contacted me with a 111-week waiting time, a relatively young person who was working successfully, saving a little bit of money, but as a result of a wait for an operation, she has had to stop working. She's unemployed. She's living life in pain. So instead of contributing to our society, she's on a 111-week waiting time. That waiting list, that is unacceptable. And going forward, we must learn from previous strategies. And I look back in particular to the period 2011 to 2015. Minister Poots led with the Transforming Your Care proposal. And much of the content of it I can see running over into this new document. It's the same general ideas. However, Transforming Your Care didn't materialise in the way that was envisaged. The improved new services were often not supported and delivered. There was also a significant proposal in terms of Invest to Save, where new money was available from the Department of Finance for new improvements. But again, under previous ministers, Edmund Poots and Simon Hamilton, that money was diverted from those improvement schemes into the normal run-of-the-mill activity. So what I want to know is what the detailed action plan is, and how can we ensure that, unlike Transforming Your Care, that the improvements will actually be deliverable rather than just high-level strategies? Certainly.
I appreciate the member giving way. The member paints a very stark picture of the situation confronting the health service. I'm sure he would agree that these problems that he identifies began way before 2011.
Indeed, the member is quite right. The
member has an extra minute.
Michael McGimsey warned the executive that when they were inadequately funding our health service, that there would be problems. And exactly as he indicated, in the latter parts of the last assembly, he said in particular there would be difficulties, and that is exactly when the waiting list went out of control. So the member is quite right. He is quite right. They were predictable, and the executive were warned about it by Michael McGimsey. So I'm aware that the Bengoa report aims to look at new models of care, and we eagerly await further details. Clearly, there is a need to improve local care in the community. Certainly, I'm aware of difficulties in the current funding arrangement, with frequently constituents having difficulty having support to allow their loved ones to live safely in their own homes. And I suspect that's largely around the funding arrangements, whether imposed directly by the department or ignoring the funding arrangements, which are unable to attract new staff into the agencies who are providing that support. I also look in terms of my Stanton constituency, where we are bereft of secondary care to a degree. We do not have the support that exists in many other locations. East Antrim does not have an accident an emergency unit. It does not have a minor injury unit, nor does it have any of these new all-singing, all-dancing health and wellbeing centres. There is a need for investment both in capital and resource to ensure that these new teams that are being talked about, multidisciplinary teams, can be delivered locally.
where all health professionals can work closely together and improve the service. So I would hope that that will be delivered as a result of this proposal.
Ask the member to conclude his remarks.
I urge members to ensure that this will actually be delivered and not just talked about as to previous schemes which were there. We need actual delivery, not just strategies and consultations. Thank you.
Mr. Pat Sheehan.
I could spend the whole of my 5 minutes talking about all the negative aspects of the health service, and there's no point doing that. I prefer to accentuate the positive. And, you know, everyone here in this house knows of a good news story about the health service, someone who has been helped. Sometimes we hear of almost miraculous recoveries of people who have had to be dealt with by the health and social care system. I can think of nothing more important than the health of our citizens, and that includes the delivery of health and social care to those citizens. And I want at this point to pay tribute to all those who work in the health and social care system, the clinicians, nurses, and all the ancillary staff. And they're one of the most positive things that we could be talking about here today, and the great work that they do in the health system. In a sense, there's nothing really new in the report from Bengoa Systems, not Structures. There have been other reports. We've heard mention of the Donaldson report, Transforming Your Care. However, none of those reports have been implemented. Whether it was the will wasn't there, the resources weren't there, or whatever. But what they do, along with the new report, is that they create that framework or that route map in which the health service can be transformed. It's clear on this occasion that there is a commitment there to implement change and follow the direction of travel as prescribed by Professor Bengoa. That commitment is evident from what we have heard from the Minister and from the Executive. Yes, certainly.
Grateful to the member giving way. Just wanted to tease out the implications of what he's saying. He's saying we now have support from the DEP on the Executive for delivering this version of reform, but previously he said this report is very similar to all the previous reports which were under DEP ministers. By implication, is he saying that Sinn Féin are at fault for failing to support the DEP ministers, and we've actually missed the opportunity over the past number of years to get on with this?
The member has an extra minute.
I thank the Minister for his intervention, and I'm not so sure that that is the case. However, I don't want to hark back to the past. The Minister, or the member was there himself in the Executive as a Minister, so maybe he's more informed on these issues than I am. But let me quote Professor Bengoa, who said in the committee a couple of weeks ago that many other regions and countries are trying to bring about change in their health system. Some are doing it by throwing resources at it and throwing funding at it. Some are doing it by trying to transform the system but not providing the resources. But Professor Bengoa said this region is actually unique in that we are intent on both transformation and providing additional funding. So if that's not a measure of the commitment of the Minister and the Executive, I'm not sure what is. I represent a constituency that has some of the worst health inequalities across these islands. And unless there's a change and there's transformation, those health inequalities will continue to grow. Waiting lists will get longer, and the percentage of the block grant going towards health and social care will increase. There's only one solution, and that solution is transformation. So let's all of us draw a line here today. I've listened to a number of speakers so far. I didn't detect any opposition to the need for radical transformation of our health and social care system. And, you know, in fact, health, in a sense, is a unique issue. Every single one of us sitting here today, And every single person who's sitting listening to this debate is at some time going to be affected by ill health, whether it's themselves, members of their families, or friends, or so on. Every single person. And as I said in the debate last week, you know, ill health doesn't discriminate along party political lines. And, you know, I make this appeal every time I talk about on a health issue in this chamber. Let's all of us work together. You know, this is an issue that affects all of us. It's absolutely right that the minister should be held to account, as every minister should. There's absolutely no doubt about that. But health is unique in that it affects us all, and if we all work together, we can make more progress. Not for ourselves, but for the people out there who we represent. So I leave you with that thought, Aciún Cóirle. Working together is the best way to resolve all these problems.
Call Mr. Mark Durkin.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I rise in support of the motion and of the amendment. Mr. Sheehan, in speaking there, said that he didn't detect any opposition to the need for radical transformation, and I think that's fair enough, and that's because there isn't any. I don't think anyone in here, or anyone really anywhere, could oppose the notion that our healthcare system needs reformed. We see that every day. We hear that every day. We hear it in our constituency offices. We might hear it around our kitchen tables. We hear it on and over the airwaves. Many people have to live with the fact that the healthcare system that we do have, that we have allowed to evolve, is far from perfect and not fit for purpose. But for some time now, we've been promised a magic bullet that would cure all the ills within our health service. And I think it's fair enough to say that since May, largely any criticism or question that has been levelled at the Department of Health, or indeed of the Minister, and I don't think there's been much in the way of criticism of the Minister, but has been responded to with almost a stock answer that the Bengoa report is going to sort that out. So therefore, a lot of...
I appreciate the member giving way. The member would also want to reflect, I presume, on the comments of his opposition colleague, Mr. Beggs, who any time the problems that are pointed out that existed prior to 2011, the stock answer that comes is Michael McGimsey asked for more money. The beauty of the Bengoa report is that it is institutional reform plus additional investment.
The member has an extra minute.
I thank the member for the intervention. I'm not sure I thank him for the extra minute he's got me right enough. But I would certainly concur with his view that there's more to it than more money. It's about how we do things differently, not how we spend more money on doing the same old things. But a lot of expectation and anticipation was allowed to build up around Bengoa, a lot of suspense. And then when it was published, I think the fact that it was so similar in many respects to reports that we had received and read and seen before meant that there was a wee bit of an anticlimax almost. And I found that very much among the media, and that they were almost searching for negativity in reaction or response to the report. And I have to say, in response to Mr. Middleton's remarks, that they didn't really find or get much negativity from, I can certainly speak for myself, and I believe my opposition colleague, as he described Mrs. Dobson. What we did do was ask questions around the lack of detail in the report, and I think it would be a dereliction of duty of us, not just of us as opposition MLAs, but any of us here as MLAs, as public representatives, to ask questions about how this plan is going to be implemented, how it's going to be delivered, how it's going to improve healthcare for those out there that need it, and those of us who undoubtedly someday will. The problem with the reports that this is so similar to in the past has been the failure to implement them. And well, Mr. Farrey made an interjection there around the fact and highlighted the fact, really, we've been told a lot that it's different this time. This is a report that the executive fully endorses. I don't recall the executive not endorsing transforming your care, for example. So let's just make sure that it's more than the executive even that will endorse this plan, certainly.
Grateful to the member giving way. One of the most bizarre things about our system of government is that the issues regarding health reform weren't actually brought to the last executive. There was zero discussion at any occasion around Transform Your Care or Donaldson. It was purely around money. And it is actually quite perverse in a society like ours that we don't actually discuss the big issues. It's only the transactional business that is brought to the executive. Nothing strategic was ever discussed.
I thank the member for his intervention. Can assure him it will be different this time now that we've got away with those pesky parties. there'd certainly be a bit of concern from us, it has been expressed, around the lack of specifics in the report. You know, and the amendment calls for more meat on the bones, as I did in the morning of the publication. I think it's very important that we see that soon, that we give certainty to people and to places who might have concerns around the future of facilities in their area. I think that's inevitable, given the reconfiguration of services that is necessary, and that will ultimately lead, whatever way it's dressed up, to the closure of services and withdrawal of services from areas. And while Bengoa is and will form the foundation of the Minister's vision or the Minister's policy, what we won't allow is for Bengoa to be a fig leaf for every difficult or unpopular decision that has to be taken by the Minister or any health trust, wherever they may be. There's a need for so much. We spoke about the reconfiguration of services, improved care in the community, improved primary care, enhanced role for GPs, and enhanced role for community pharmacy and allied health professionals. These enhanced roles have to be matched with and by enhanced resources. Just, I'm conscious I haven't that long left, so I will touch on one thing, and that's a question that Mr. Carroll had asked the Minister on the morning of her statement. And that, and in response to Mr. Carroll, the Minister said that she was working towards a position where we do not need to use the independent sector. I was just would like to ask the Minister, is that applicable across the board? I think she answered that in terms of dealing with elective surgery and waiting lists, but is this applicable in social care too? Is this applicable to nursing homes and residential homes where statutory provision is extremely poor and is currently being closed?
Members, time is up.
Stealth.
Call Mr. Gerry Carroll.
Thank you, I want to thank the members for bringing this issue to the floor of the Assembly today. And there's been a lot of discussion in the aftermath of the publication of the strategy and about the Bengoa report itself. And we all know that the health service is in crisis. We know our hospital waiting lists are dangerously long. People are waiting years to be seen by a specialist or to be operated on. And indeed, my own nieces and nephews have been unfortunate. They've been sick in the last week and have waited long hours to be treated in the children's. I've also been recently contacted, Mr. Speaker, by a father whose five-year-old child is waiting 18 months on an important operation on her mouth. And this is completely unfair. It's unacceptable, but unfortunately it's a widespread problem for people having to wait long periods of time. I think it is a shocking indictment of the current state of affairs that we have a postcode lottery where if you're from areas of high deprivation and poverty, you have to wait longer to be treated. If you live in places like West Belfast, you will wait longer compared with other wealthier areas in the north. It's a shocking disparity that needs to be tackled. And the reason why people are stuck on these waiting lists is because we have seen systemic cutbacks over the last several years. We saw the city A&E close, putting huge pressure under the Royal. We saw a reduction in the amount of beds available for patients. We saw a privatised recruitment selection problem where there's a long and often complicated process to actually recruit staff. And indeed, the shortage of staff is leading to the closure of the Meadowlands unit in Musgrave Hospital, which has been in the news recently. So cutbacks and not enough staff is leading us down this road where services are reduced or stopped altogether. Some would say it's intentional, others would say it's bad workforce planning. And staff are doing tremendous work. They are the lions in our health service, but they're under huge pressures. Many health workers are working against the clock, working long hours and not taking breaks just to provide the service they are so committed to. We're also seeing people retiring and they either aren't being replaced at all
or increasingly being replaced by agency staff. And this casualisation of the workforce must come to an end, and the fact that tens of millions of pounds are being spent on paying recruitment agencies who are making an amazing fortune out of this process needs to come to an end as well. It needs to be tackled immediately. And millions of taxpayers' pounds should be put into the health service, not in the pockets of recruitment agencies or in private companies for that matter. And just this week, just last week, we saw Richard Branson, a multi-millionaire, get his hands on a huge section of the health service. So I think we'll have to be clear that private companies that are designed to make profit at all costs should have absolutely no role in our health service. And we have to ask the question today, will this strategy, will the implementation of this document proposed by the Minister and backed by the Executive address the problems we're currently experiencing, or will it lead to the further cutting back of our health service and the further encroachment? Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you very much. Thank the Member for giving the intervention. Whilst I accept what you're saying, and it certainly is not the answer that we would want to see in terms of using private health care, but do you not accept that that child that you're talking about who's having to wait 18 months will have to wait a lot longer if the Minister in the short term does not use those kind of methods in order to reduce the waiting lists?
I think the member has an extra minute.
The point is the money should be redirected back into the health service, not into the hands of private companies. So recruit more staff in the health service and reduce the waiting lists. And in the general debate, there's been much talk of the experts and the expert panel, people who are no doubt highly qualified in their fields. But who knows best how our health service runs and how it can be improved than the people who work on the coalface. And the trade unions, the trade union movement, have been excluded from this whole process. They came and spoke at the Health Committee. They've had no representation on the expert panel. And I think it's shocking that organisations that represent tens of thousands of healthcare staff have not been front and centre in this process. And we hear the talk of rationalisation, the rationalisation of our health service. I think you can butter it up whatever way you like, but for me, this is code. It's a code word for cutbacks. And how can we improve our health service? How can we cut waiting times by cutting our health service? It cannot be done. So I think we need to put money in to defend our services. And you know, indeed, the underlying language in which this report follows an English NHS template where we see daily reports of organisational meltdown, financial crisis and privatisation that surround these new structures, and that should cause us all great concern. And now Bevan, one of the key architects of the NHS, says the NHS will survive if there are people around to defend it. So I hope over the next few weeks that people will get out, campaign to defend our NHS, and they'll have support for People Before Profit in that process. Thank you.
Call Mr Jim Mallister.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. There probably is no sector more afflicted with all the buzzwords that have become fashionable, like transformation, as if that is going to cover up the failures of the past and deliver a new utopia. But I think we do have to ask more probing questions, like, did the previous executive, for example, lead us in the right direction in terms of providing basic health care by reducing the number of hospital beds by over 10%, and then being surprised at the log jams, the near traffic jams of people on trolleys in the corridors of our hospitals? But now the answer to all that is, oh, let's grab some nice buzzwords, transformation, proving outputs, from the very people who delivered much of the shambles that we've been affected to in recent times. And I do have to say that I see within the Bengoa report and within the consultation document of last Friday essentially a stratagem for stripping out from many of our hospitals services that they presently provide. And it's done on a well-tried template. And the consultation document is a perfect example and model of that. In order to obtain the preordained outcomes of reducing and stripping out facilities in hospitals, You have to build a case. As they built, for example, sometimes in a quite phony way, in regard to the Belfast City Hospital Emergency Department, which was closure was only meant to be temporary. Of course, that was to avoid a consultation. But the words that were used was, it's not safe. We can't get the staff. We had an experience with the Causeway Hospital in Coleraine, where when we were going through a dark patch and there were those trying to diminish it, and the claim was, we can't get the staff. Of course, that was rectified because it could be rectified. But very often, when government wants to do something, it sets up the various criteria to fit into where they want to get to. And that's why in these criteria, it's so much about safety, but being clinician-led, as if that's the answer to everything. Because most clinicians, they want a handy time in terms of if we can all work in the Greater Belfast area, we'll all choose to work in the Greater Belfast area. So devising the consultation document in those ways is geared, as I suspect, to producing this stratagem of stripping out services in many hospitals. And where that concerns me the most is in respect of our rural community. Now, this is the minister. This is the minister who, when she wore the agricultural hat, brought to this House the Rural Needs Bill. She told us during the debates on that, the key principles of this bill mean rural issues will be embedded, as a matter of course, in the development and delivery of all government strategies and policies. The government will take a joined up and collaborative approach in taking account of rural needs when designing public services. Sounds great. Where did rural proofing come in the consultation issued on Friday? Tucked on as a little afterthought on page 20. And tucked on in terms where it's quite clear, yes, we'll go through the motions, but we'll not pay any heed, because it contains this key phrase. We'll fully engage in consulting rural communities before finalising the service change. So in other words, we're going to make the change, then we'll consult with the rural communities, and then we'll finalise the change. Where's the embedding that was promised by this minister in respect of rural proofing? Indeed,
ask the member to conclude his remarks.
In Bengoa's report, did he ever even consult with rural interests? So I do fear that all of that is feeding in to a reduction and diminishing of services for many of my constituents.
Member's time is up. I call the Minister of Health, Ms. Michelle O'Neill, to respond to the debate, and the Minister has up to 20 minutes.
I've got a can call you, and I'm a bit hoarse, so bear with me. Can I thank all those members that have contributed in a positive way today, in a constructive way today? I'm very keen to keep talking and keep coming back to this conversation as we transform our health and social care. The prize at the end of that transformation is better patient outcomes, and that's the prize which we all need to work towards. I really very much welcome the fact that the Alliance Party have brought forward amendment, because it actually puts a bit of meat in the bones, because the original motion itself just merely notes the publication of the report. I would correct the member that proposed the motion that this is the first time we've had an opportunity to debate this issue. I think you'll find it's not. I've actually been to the Health Committee. I know you were in China at the time, but we have actually discussed it there. And we also discussed it here on the day that I launched the report on the 25th of October. I launched my ambitious 10-year approach to transforming health and social care, health and wellbeing 2026, delivering together, as well as the expert panel's report, Systems Not Structures, Changing Health and Social Care. And I'm very grateful, as I said, for the opportunity once again to set out the key elements of the approach. I recognise that many members in the Chamber will have had read and had time to digest both of these documents over the last number of weeks, although I would question if some members have read the report in any type of entirety, because whenever I hear some of the contributions in the comments, I would very much doubt that that's the fact, because I think a lot of people are missing the point. But I will take the opportunity again today to, I suppose, to rehearse some of the key issues to make sure that members are as fully briefed and absolutely understand the direction of travel. But I won't rehearse all the detail which I've done on previous occasions. I think the case, and we all agree that the case for change has been very well made. An ageing population is good news for us all, and it's testament to the hard work and dedication of all those working in our health and social care system. But it also presents capacity and demand issues. Our system was designed to meet the needs of a population in the 20th century, so I think it's logical that it's struggling to cope with 21st century needs and expectations. Waiting lists have continued to grow, which I have always said is totally unacceptable to me, but I believe that's only a symptom of the problem that we face. Health inequalities, and some members referred to this, continue to divide our society. In 2016, it's absolutely unacceptable to me that our socioeconomic status dictates our health outcomes, where those living in the centre of this city can expect to live 9 years less than those who live a few miles up the road. Like those who have come before me, I have invested in frontline service development and improvement initiatives. And while this has alleviated some of the pressure on the system, it is by no means fixing the underlying problem and the underlying issues. Current delivery models continue to have a negative impact on the quality and the experience of care right across the north. Not only are these models of care outdated, they are unsustainable, and if we continue to do more of the same, by 2026 the HSE will need 90% of the executive budget to merely stand still.
I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way. I asked Mr Carroll from West Belfast to give way, but he wouldn't. Does the Minister agree with me that if you're going to stand to your feet and say we should be investing millions and millions more in the health service, it would be helpful to the debate if people would give us actual figures in terms of the level of additional investment they want to see?
I mean, obviously, I would totally agree with that. I mean, I think it's very easy to stand on the sidelines and to chirp away and to say this is what we should be doing, to write to me all the time about waiting lists and how unacceptable you find it. But if we don't have real meaningful transformation and we don't have actually real concrete plans in place to transform the peace, then we're not going to be able to assist those people, those mothers, daughters, sons, all those people who find themselves waiting to be seen in our health service. So transformation is absolutely key. Cancorlia, it's not my intention to paint an overly pessimistic picture of health and social care, but really what I want to do to emphasise to members that if transformation does not happen, we can expect to see health and social care services in further significant decline. Health is a basic human right, and I believe in a universal health service based on need and free at the point of delivery. And my overriding ambition is for us all to lead long, healthy and active lives. I want to see a future in which people are provided with the information, education and the support to enable them to keep well in the first place. When care is needed, it should be safe and of high quality. Those who use services and indeed those who provide them should be treated with dignity, respect and compassion. I listened to one of the Mr Alistair's comments in relation to quality and in relation to safety. Patient safety has to be paramount. Patient safety has to be the first consideration in terms of any services that we provide. So I'd very much be guided by that principle. My vision on the transformation journey we have embarked on is ambitious and rightly so. It will require whole system transformation across primary, secondary and community care and a radical change to the way that we plan, design and provide services. Holistic transformation will allow new, innovative ways of working and patient-centred models of care to flourish. Moving away from a model of activity-based performance to performance measures based on patient outcomes will allow health and social care staff to provide the right care at the right time, in the right place. We will explore where all island services can further be developed to bring mutual benefit for patients on this island. We have already initiated a programme of work with counterparts in Dublin to explore all island services, including transplantation, rare diseases and mental health perinatal services. By implementing new models of care and increasing our regional and all-island networks for specialist services, we will not only deliver better outcomes for patients, but also alleviate pressure on vital acute services, including reducing hospital admission rates, speeding up hospital discharge, and reducing the length of stays for those patients who need to go to hospital. To begin this journey, I have already set out some key actions. I have agreed to increase GP training places to 111, 12 next year and 14 the year after that. Commissioned 5 training places on the Advanced Nurse Practitioners Programme, continued investment in practice-based pharmacists, and I'm reviewing the role of physician associates could play in our system. I'm committed to investing in the workforce of the health and social care system. Our staff are our greatest asset, and I recognise that they are under significant pressure. I have witnessed over the last number of months the outstanding work of HSE staff and the positive impact they have on people's lives. I'm therefore committed to developing a workforce strategy by spring 2017 and a range of other immediate actions to start to address some critical workforce challenges. However, I recognise that some of the long-term systemic workforce issues we face will take time, leadership and sustained effort to resolve. Securing better health and wellbeing outcomes for patients and other people who use health and social care services will be at the centre of the transformation programme that I have announced. The experiences and needs of service users and their families will therefore be at the forefront of shaping our new service model. I am therefore committed to ensuring that the HSC works in partnership with service users to design and implement the lasting and meaningful changes we need to improve the health outcomes for our population. And this is what I mean by delivering together. This new way of engaging patients is built on the principle of co-production. Co-production will underpin how we engage service users in the future in designing new services, new treatment pathways or at the point of care. Patients and service users have a vital contribution to make to transformation. I have already embarked on a period of engagement with those who use services and staff right across HSC to listen to their views on the future of health and social care services. We need greater collective clinical and professional leadership throughout the HSC, supported by skilled and abled managers. That is why I have asked my officials to develop a system-wide HSC leadership strategy to be produced by next summer, and resources will be invested to support staff and leaders to develop the necessary skills and the behaviours that will be crucial as we move forward. We must all accept that the role of our hospitals will fundamentally change. Hospitals are not always the most appropriate place for all care to be received, and where it is safe to do so, people should expect to be treated in a setting closer to home. Cancoria, for some, attending medical appointments or receiving treatment can be a daunting and sometimes stressful situation. There is strong evidence that concentrating specialist procedures and services in a small number of sites produces significantly better outcomes. It is the opposite in our current system, where emergency and planned care services are mixed together because they are located in the same facility. And this perpetuates our long waiting lists and system-wide backlogs are created. By further developing ambulatory assessment and treatment centres, we will allow health and social care professionals to assess, diagnose and, where appropriate, provide same-day treatment to patients. While elective care centres will be developed to carry out less complex planned treatments right across the north, the establishment of these dedicated centres will be a resource for the region, and the way they will operate will be designed around patients. It is well evidenced that this type of configuration of services can reduce waiting times and prevent the system backlog we experience today. I want to see a health and social care system which is efficient and sustainable, where best practice is the norm and where investment is made in areas that will positively impact service users. We should have a system that encourages innovation, and where there are good pockets of work that are co-produced and showing high quality patient outcomes, we should be able to scale those up at pace. Finally, I'm determined to realise the potential that modern information technology provides. Making better use of technology and data is essential if we're to move forward to a model focused on service users. If we're to utilise our entire information resource to better inform the treatment of patients and free up health professionals' time to care. I've said it before and I'll say it again, it's a privilege to be the Minister for Health, and I am committed to this programme of transformation and the principles of co-production. I am determined that delivering together is not put on a shelf and forgotten about, but it is used and intended as the roadmap for transformation. As the Health Minister, I will lead this work with energy, with passion and with pace. Last week, I launched the public consultation on the criteria for assessing the sustainability of health and social care services as recommended by the expert panel in their report. The consultation will run longer than the normal 8 weeks to take account of the Christmas period and will include a series of consultation meetings right across the north to allow as many people as possible to contribute. Further information on the dates and venues and invitation arrangements for these meetings will be announced shortly. This week I'll be launching my department's paediatric hospital and community-based services strategy and paediatric palliative and end-of-life care strategy. These documents set out the approach for further improving the delivery of services over the next 10 years, subject to securing the transformation investment required to implement the strategies. Both strategies will be taken forward fully aligned with the priorities and objectives for transformation set out in Delivering Together, with the clear aim of delivering better health and wellbeing outcomes for our children in the north. Later this month, I will also be launching a new diabetes service framework, which will realise a vision of care designed to transform services for people living with diabetes or at risk of developing diabetes, subject to securing the necessary investment. I'll be launching a public consultation on proposals to modernise the delivery of pathology services. This will include or involve building a sustainable, high-quality pathology service designed to support the vital area of diagnostics well into the future. Cancorlia, I have to say I have been really encouraged with the positive response that I have been receiving in relation to the vision document Delivering Together. But I want to ensure that everyone has their opportunity to have their say on the criteria for sustainability of services, which, if adopted by my department, will be at the heart of informing future decisions to be taken about reconfiguring services. Since the launch, I have spent considerable time engaging with staff, with service users right across a range of locations and settings, including Craigavon Area Hospital, the Ulster Hospital Emergency Department, Old Sea House, an integrated community mental health care centre, and their reaction to both my vision and the expert panel's report has been overwhelmingly positive, and they are telling me about their appetite for change has never been stronger. This is only the beginning as I plan to ramp up this type of engagement. I have committed to chair an advisory board which will provide strategic leadership and oversight required to deliver this transformation. Membership of this board will be drawn from the field of independent experts, unions and user representatives, along with the permanent secretary of my department. The structure will also include a transformation implementation group responsible for driving forward the transformation programme led by my permanent secretary. I will continue to work with executive colleagues and members of this House, and I'll continue to work with my executive colleagues in relation to securing the additional funding necessary to facilitate transformation, manage backlog and maintain current services. I will reaffirm my commitment to update this Assembly every 6 months with the progress of this transformation process. We must all realise that change cannot happen without investment, and we all realise that. Investment does not only take the form of pounds and pence, but it's also about political and system-wide leadership. Finding the time to change and making a conscious effort to break down silos to move to a regional and all-island approaches where necessary. All of us have an important role to play as we embark on this journey. I will not shy away from the difficult conversations and decisions. I would ask all members in this House to match my resolve. Delivering together, I believe we have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to transform our HSE into a world-class service, and I look forward to working constructively with all those members who want to deliver better positive health outcomes for all of those people that may need our health and social care systems in the years, months, years and weeks ahead.
I call Mr Stephen Farrey to wind on the amendment, and the member has up to 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for her comments and also her commitment to working with the Assembly and giving frequent reports back both to the Assembly and indeed to the Committee, and setting a positive example in that regard. It is important to bear in mind that if we are to see this generational change in terms of our health and social care system, that we do need to find as wide a political consensus as possible, because there are some very difficult decisions that are coming down the line. I want to just echo what my colleague Paula Bradshaw said at the start, that we are not interested in alliance in simply being opposition for opposition's sake. We are always constructive, and we are willing to support the Minister and Executive in terms of delivering upon this new vision and ensuring that we do see positive change in our health system. Of course, provided that indeed that the reports are followed through and that expert advice is given its proper place and does guide us in terms of the way forward. I do note the comments from, I think it was Catherine Seely, about Sinn Féin opposing populism in this regard, and I think that is a very important statement to be made, and we look forward to that being the way forward. Of course, as many people have said, the current approach isn't sustainable, and that lack of sustainability applies in two different respects. One is the fact that we aren't getting the best in terms of outcomes and results in the system. It's not as good as it could or should be. And secondly, that our finances are in a difficult and challenging situation. Based on the current configuration of the health system, we are looking at healthcare inflation in the region of 5-6% per annum, which is well in advance of the ability of the executive to invest resources. So therefore, we do need to have a proper discussion in terms of finances. And while the need for the 10-year implementation plan has been well received by the Assembly, and we certainly endorsed that and welcome that response, it is important that we also recognise the issues regarding finance, and those perhaps have not been as teased out as much in this debate as certainly I would have liked that to be. So we do need to focus a little bit in terms of the finance. Certainly, we have to accept that there is a need to invest further in our health and social care system in order for it to become more effective and sustainable. So we have to invest in that transformation process. But how much and where are we going to find that money from are the key issues that are going to face us in that regard. Christopher Stalford and indeed the Minister were quite right to challenge Jerry Carroll in terms of how much he wants to see invested in the health system. But equally, they have a duty to spell out how much these reports are actually going to amount to in terms of that transformation and indeed where they intend to find the money. Now, both the DUP and Sinn Féin went into the last election with a commitment to spend an additional £1 billion on health by 2021, a very nice round number which does indeed take into account healthcare inflation. But today we need to know, does that commitment still stand? And also how they intend to separate that commitment from the wider financial context that we are facing. Because even in this current financial year, where the health system got a 2% increase, that still fell short of healthcare inflation. So the system this year is already under challenge. But even that modest increase in health spending came at the expense of virtually every other government department facing a cut. And we know that our block grant over the course of this mandate is set to flatline at best. But now we're faced with the effects of Brexit, and the impact upon the UK's public finances are very uncertain. And indeed, there are warnings of an even bigger black hole opening over the coming years in that regard. So the implications for Northern Ireland are unclear. We also have potential wider implications in terms of funding a lower rate of corporation tax to help transform our economy. We may need to invest further in agricultural subsidies locally if that is cut off from Westminster. But one thing is clear, that we're not going to be getting our share of £350 million per week repatriated from Brussels. There's also the uncertainty around the current in-year situation, in that healthcare inflation is running at 5-6%, with a budget increase of 2%, and very, very little in terms of monitoring round bids. So that does indicate the potential for a black hole to open during this financial year, pre-reform. How are we going to manage in-year? And finally, looking ahead to implementation, it's important to bear in mind this has to be a cross-cutting issue.
Ask the member to conclude his remarks.
All government departments, and the implementation plan at this stage is solely dealing with health issues, and we need to see a lot more in terms of cross-cutting activity across all executive departments. Thank you.
I call Mr. Robbie Butler to wind the debate on the motion, and the member has up to 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to wind on the motion that has been brought to the House by my party colleague, Joanne Dobson. I find it very encouraging that there's been such a wealth of debate on this motion today, and I feel this shows a real appetite to tackle the problems within our health service. We all in this Assembly agree that the health service needs to change, and to change for the better. And standing still is no longer an option. There are too many people on waiting lists. Those who are on them are waiting far too long. And the absence of a strategic workforce plan is contributing to a building over-reliance on locum staff and targets being stretched. The implications are felt right across the board, whether it's in A&E or care in the community. The people of Northern Ireland deserve a fully functional health service, one which not only delivers but is in fact sustainable, accessible and affordable. And for those reasons, I am encouraged that the current executive appears to be moving to address these issues with a high degree of priority. And there are a number of points that I would wish to focus on, Mr. Speaker, this afternoon. Firstly, I am encouraged. I am encouraged at the content of both of the reports we are discussing today, which is at odds with a number of speakers' points today. I feel that the outworkings of the Health and Wellbeing Report has the potential to become the basis of a new framework of sustainable health care provision in Northern Ireland. The Minister has heard us call for more detail, and I hope over the coming weeks and months that the detail will indeed be forthcoming. And one point the Minister will not be surprised to hear me raise again is about mental health. Northern Ireland, as we know, suffers a disproportionately high level of mental health illness in the UK and indeed across the British Isles. Not only do we suffer unduly high rates of mental illness in more deprived areas, but there is significant evidence to show that the legacy of the Troubles has significantly contributed to our mental ill health. The Ulster Unionists have been campaigning and championing adequate mental health care provision for many years now, and so I am particularly pleased to see the commitments in the report for tackling mental health issues. I am pleased to see a commitment for additional funding for mental health interventions in primary care and to make available early support services such as mental health hubs. And I agree with the sentiments espoused by the Minister that mental health care should have a parity of esteem. But I would urge her to start putting some measures in place to actually deliver this. As a starting point, I would once again call on the Executive to recognise the merits of appointing a mental health champion. I recognise the Minister has said she is prepared to take up a role, and that role of a champion, and I commend her for that. But I think the gravity of poor mental health is so severe that we need an independent champion to ensure that the Minister and her Executive are genuinely responding to the need. On page 15 of the Health and Wellbeing report, the Department rightly identifies acute care at home as being a service ripe for reform. With advancements in technology and telemedicine, it is much easier for patients to remain in their own home than even a few years ago. But I would urge the Minister to stick to her word and better integrate care at home with social care within the next 3 years. The main point I would like to make in this respect is that the Trust must ensure that the staff on the ground not only have the support, but the time to deliver that service. Specifically, I would remind the Minister of the report by the Commissioner for Older People for Northern Ireland last year, when it was recommended that NICE guideline NG21 should be embedded into the standards for the delivery of domiciliary care here, and that calls for less, or calls of less than 30 minutes duration should generally not be used. The Minister rightly identifies practice-based pharmacies as a means to alleviate some of the pressures facing general practice today. But I would urge her and her officials not to overlook the increasingly important role that community pharmacies can and do play in delivering a fully integrated service. Last week, I and many members of this House visited local community pharmacies and were able to see at first hand the role that they play and the support that they offer our communities. Therefore, I sincerely hope the Minister is not minded to follow the reductions to community pharmacies as proposed in England. I know it was recently debated in Westminster and members of the DUP surprisingly sided with the Government, so it was understandably raised some concerns within our constituencies. Over the weekend, I heard the Minister once again state the importance of consultation and the necessity to take members of the public along the journey with any proposed reforms. I would urge her, however, not just to consult for consultation's sake, as Mr Alistair has alluded to. For instance, I would use my local example of the Lagan Valley Hospital as one where the local population have not been treated with that respect and the respect that they deserve. During the summer of 2011, the Lagan Valley accident and emergency had its service reduced to daytime and weekends only. At the time, staffing concerns were cited, and the people of Lisburn were assured that at that stage the decision was only going to be temporary. Despite the supposed concerns of the Minister at that time, the opposite has happened, with the services further reduced. And I'm only using this as an example of how not to mislead. Yes, indeed.
Does the member recognise that saying something is temporary is a wheeze by government to avoid consultation? Because when you propose a permanent closure, there's a formal consultation process. When you dress it up as temporary, they avoid that. And isn't that what happened at the City Hospital and at Wagon Valley?
I thank the member for his point, and I think his point has been well made, and there's been nobody in this House that could argue anything different. At this point, Mr Speaker, I'd just like to recap on some of the comments made by some of the members. I commend my party colleague Joanne Dobson for indeed bringing the motion. And there were a number of points that stood out, no more so than her personal account of a mother and the family's experience of using today's overburdened and stretched services and the risks that our sufferers and service users are exposed to. We talked about who, where and when, and that's really what the plan must get us to. It must get us to that level of detail. Paula Bradshaw, on her amendment, called for recognition that care should be free at point of access and also that the service is indeed broken and needs to be fixed, and I would agree with that. But Paula also mentioned the three C's, and I think this is worth noting, especially for the Minister. She talked about commitment, courage and clarity. Well, I can assure the Minister that she will get the commitment and she will get the courage from this House. All she needs to do is bring the clarity and the detail. So the three C's. Yes, indeed, Minister.
Member, does he agree with the principle of co-production and co-design and actually listening to service users, patients and making sure that we give them ownership of the care pathway that they take?
I absolutely do. I think at the core of this must be putting patients first, Minister. There's nobody in this House will disagree with that. And on the point of consultation, the patients need to be listened to, and I think that was the point I made in my address. I'm going to pay very little time to this, Mr Speaker, this next bit, because two members of this House wasted 2 minutes of their 5 minutes to attack the opposition. I thought it was petty, I thought it was very disappointing, and I just wondered, did they write their speeches together? It'd be another way that the executive could be working collaboratively behind the scenes. It's incredible. Mr McGrath, that's all I'm going to say about those two members. Mr McGrath talked about openness and transparency, two fantastic words, and they're turning into buzzwords, really. That's what they're turning into, and we've heard about buzzwords, and we really don't want to be faced in a grown-up 2016 modern-day assembly where we've moved so far in the last 18, 24 years and beat these words about this House. I'd be really disappointed at the end of this 4 years, never mind 10 years, if we're still talking about openness and transparency, Mr McGrath. Again, Mr McGrath, another good one, the ambulance response times. And there is a disparity in the provision of healthcare in this country, depending on where you live. And we talk about the postcode lottery. That's something that I particularly would be keeping a close eye on with regard to the response times and how that is addressed. Thank you, Mr McGrath, for that one. Gary Middleton? Nope. I'll not go there. Okay, well, what we'll actually do, we'll go to Pat Sheehan, because what Pat said at the start was that he mentioned he wasn't going to waste his 5 minutes, and I commend him for it. He didn't waste any of his 5 minutes in talking about this. He got straight to the meat, and I commend him for that. And he talked about transformation, and he talked about detail, which we all know. Mr Durkin, thank you. I always like listening to you. You can do it without reading, which is admirable. But that'll come with experience. He talked about failure in the past to implement, and reiterated Stephen Farrey's earlier point about previous reports just sitting on the shelf and not really addressing the issues. And that is what we must learn from the mistakes, indeed, of the past. I'm sorry if I didn't mention anybody else. There was plenty of other good speakers there. But in conclusion, Mr Speaker, we have seen many good points raised in this motion, some critical and some commendable. Mr Speaker, I put it to the Minister of Health that whilst 9 or 10 years might seem like a long journey, the reality is that without clear signposting, without clear measurable targets, I fear that the time will slowly slip away, like my time slipping away now. And thank you, Mr Speaker.
The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it.